Hello, my name is Dr. Don Ewing. I'm the Executive Director for the International Academy of Biological Dentistry and Medicine. I started off as a dental hygienist, and I think it's really important that the hygienists get more involved with the biological office. Currently, I am a doctor of integrative medicine and work very closely with biological dentists and with physicians. What you need to know when you're working in a biological office. Well, the International Academy of Biological Dentistry and Medicine is dedicated to advancing excellence in the art and science of biological dentistry and encouraging the highest standards of ethical conduct and responsible patient care. Here's the definition of a biological dentist. They are concerned with the whole body, the effects of all dental materials, techniques, and procedures. It invites the best clinical practices and technologies of traditional dentistry and medicine with a wider range of modalities beyond the conventional practice. Biological dentistry acknowledges, appreciates, and considers the complex and dynamic relationships between the oral health and systemic health within the context of the whole person. These things are inseparable. So how is biological dentistry different from a regular dentist? Well, they don't use amalgams. They practice safe mercury removal. They test the individuals for allergies or reactions to materials before they use them. They don't use fluoride. These are just a few things that makes a biological dentist office unique. There are some people that I'd like to give credit to for really starting the world of biological dentistry. Dr. Hal Huggins, he's the one that really came to the forefront of mercury being toxic. Dr. Reinhold Voll is the one that got very involved with an understanding that each tooth was on a meridian and affected different parts of the body. Dr. George Meinig was an endodontist that recognized that the root canals themselves were toxic. Dr. Jerry Bocow is the one that coined the common term we use, Nico lesions. Dr. Boyd Haley, we give him lots of credit in the world of mercury toxicity and helping us understand how thioaerosol and mercury interacts with the neurology of the body. And these are just a few of our mentors. Weston Price is another one. He was a dentist from Cleveland, Ohio, and he did research that showed that individuals that ate diets from their region and didn't have massive amounts of sugar in their diet had gorgeous arches with very little decay. Once sugar was introduced into their diets, then you saw a gross change in the size of the arches and the amount of decay. He wrote several books, Nutrition and Physical Degeneration, and Dental Infections and the Degenerative Diseases. And these books are still in use today at dental schools. Here's a good example of what happened once the sugar was. You see the crooked arches and you see massive quantities of decay. Weston Price Foundation is a great organization for you to join and have classes for your patients. It's really smart for you to understand the Weston Price theory so that when you're working with moms that come in and they're trying to follow Weston Price, you're able to understand what they're talking about. Biological dentistry, we hope to cover many different topics, and I'm open to teach some others if you just give me some feedback as to what. We hope to cover things like ozone and mercury toxicity, diabetes, the meridians, drug interactions, periodontal disease, pH, digestion, microscopy, options to fluoride, genetics, homeopathy, herbals, and anything else you guys can come up with. We all carry burdens. Some people have poor diets. Some people are really reactive to stress. Other people have been exposed to heavy metals. Maybe they don't have any in their mouth, but they had injections like vaccinations, or they worked in a dental environment where they were breathing mercury. Some people react to their root canals. How much someone can carry is different. A person's health is dependent on subtle energies of the body as each cell communicates with each other, kind of like a telephone game. When you're looking at the mouth, you have an opportunity to see so much about this individual. You could pick up things like meth mouth, or that someone may be at risk of being a purger, or that someone has chronic sugar exposures or dietary deficiencies. The health of the oral cavity is truly a reflection on the rest of the body. If you improve your health, your teeth and gums are less likely to have problems. If you improve the health of the mouth, it just so happens the rest of the body will improve too. Today is known as oral systemic connection. Who looks at an x-ray of a person more often than a dentist or a dental hygienist? This person isn't going to just have problems with the bone in their mouth. Even the most resistant patient to flossing has a desire to improve their health somewhere. A woman patient may have poor dental hygiene but be OCD about the wrinkles in her face. Educating her about how the face and gum tissues are so similar and how using vitamin C could improve the collagen fibers, thus improving her skin integrity. See, everyone has a desire to look younger. What tools can we use to assist the patient in their quest of health? Well, everything you were taught in school and more. The soft tissue includes the tongue. Look at it by incorporating a little Chinese tongue diagnosis. Go online and look at taking a course just for fun. You may be surprised what you pick up on people. Health can be impacted by prescriptions both positively and negatively. Because so many patients practice polypharmacy, few have a practitioner that takes the time to look for possible drug interactions or nutritional depletions. So patients get their prescriptions from multiple doctors, and no one is quarterbacking the drug management. Many prescriptions must be taken at certain times or with or without food, away from certain foods or supplements. Many common prescriptions cause depletions of calcium, magnesium, and CoQ10, which can impact our patient's periodontal health. Your office can take the time to assist in directing the patient to better health by simply looking into these for them. Then any questions that arise can be fielded directly back to their primary care. This shows the primary care that you are extremely good at taking care of the patients and go the extra mile. By not telling them to go off anything, you're not pretending to practice medicine. Writing a nice letter on behalf of your office and informing them of the information you gathered can win an ally and future referrals. Here is a website that I use often to look at drug interactions. Here's an example of a letter that you might use when trying to send something over to a primary care's office. Learn what things can impact a person's dental health. Learn more about the thyroid and the adrenals, how blood sugar swings can affect a person. What about the diet, different prescriptions, radiation treatment, stress? The list goes on and on. Document everything you do and document it in the name of oral health. If you're working in a dental office and you don't have a license that actually allows you to diagnose or treat, make sure you always bring it back somehow about how it will impact this person's health, their gingiva or their periodontal condition. You should require consents. Write a consent form that clearly states what you can and cannot do. Never misrepresent yourself or practice outside your scope of medicine or dentistry. Always have a good list of referrals. Check out the qualifications of the person you are referring to. If you make a referral and that person is truly not qualified, it could come back to haunt you. Here's what the DOT uses as a dental hygienist's qualifications and what they can do. Each state varies. Some states allow hygienists to give injections, others don't. Sometimes there are expanded duty classes that you can take, like laser or placing sealants. And every state is different, so please check out your state. Some states require that you be a 4-year degreed naturopath. Not all states are even licensed for naturopaths. Naturopaths can diagnose when they are in states that allow licensing, But again, check out your particular state. This should cover everybody. Here's what the DOT says is the title for a consultant. So if you follow these guidelines, you should be safe. This is my consultant form that I developed, and you can see on here that I make claims about what I am and what I am not. A dental hygienist can be so much more than the lady that simply cleans the teeth. In most states, a blood pressure is taken in a dental office. The patient may have not even been to a doctor for years. It would be your place to point out the need for reducing the risk of stroke by reducing their blood pressure, and that may mean a referral to their primary care. As you start putting the pieces of the patient's information together, which I call puzzle piecing, you may find a root cause that will endear your patient to you for life, even if you're not the treating physician. Who really takes the time with their patients anymore? What's the average length of an office visit with a primary care doctor nowadays? Does anyone think about their patients after the visit is over? You have sometimes an hour with that patient. You are probably the healthcare practitioner that they spend the most time with at least twice a year. What if prevention for a heart attack is actually seeing your dental hygienist? How can you make a difference? You could certainly do things like brush a teeth in a nursing home, or teach some classes in your office or off-site. You could offer literature in your office to help people understand things like their prescriptions or home care or diet. There are many different tools that a hygienist needs to learn to make advantage of looking at, like blood work. Like using a canary or a diagnodent device to help look for incipient decay and monitor it. Looking at devices like a BTA or a QFA, this particular page, you see at the top, I have some colored lines, and then in the middle, the same thing. These are actually three different reports, and what we're looking at, this one is the very top. You see that this person is hydrated when they drink 60 ounces of water a day, which was half of their body weight. They weighed 120 pounds. Then we asked them to drink only 3 cups of water a day, 24 ounces, and you can see that their hydration went down and their ability to detoxify went down. So they don't have enough water to even clean the cells in their body. And in the last set, towards the bottom, you'll see the same 3 cups of water, but a homeopathic of coffee was used. Coffee is dehydrating, but if we use it at a homeopathic dose, it rehydrates the individual, and you can see that the hydration went up and the body's ability to detox. So sometimes when people can't drink all the water they're supposed to for a day, we can help them by encouraging maybe some homeopathic remedies to go in there, or at least educating them and letting them make some choices about that. We can use a live cell and look for things like spirochetes or amoebas. We can use dry cell or send them to a practitioner that does dry cell and have them look at some things on the person's blood. Iridology, there are great iridologists in my hometown of Houston that are able to look at all kinds of different things. There's a piece of equipment called a heart rate variability that lets us know if the person's stuck in sympathetic overdrive. If you have an individual that has a problem and you do something like correct their bite, you will be able to see how that affects their immune system and their autonomic system right away by repeating the test. We have things like digital thermography. This is a piece of equipment like a wand, and you touch different points on the face, on the neck, on the arms, on the breast, and on the back, and you're able to take temperatures throughout the body and determine dysregulation in different areas. There's auricular therapy, where you can use this to help maybe with some dental pain. You can get some little beads. You're not practicing acupuncture then. It's a little seed that's on a piece of tape, and usually Shen Men is a good point. You'll see Shen Men in each one of these is a great point to just place it. There's things like thermography, which is a heat-seeking camera. Here's an individual that had some pain on their back, especially on the back of their right shoulder, and then they had some acupuncture done, and you could see that right after, the picture was taken again, and the only area that's still warm is right in the center of the back. There are things like a speed of sound photography. There used to be a piece of equipment called a cavitat. There's a few offices that still have them, but it can no longer be purchased. It was able to deliver a sound wave through the bone, and areas where you had good hydration would image green, and areas where you had diminished hydration, we assumed there would be a void in that area. So you'll see some areas that are red here. This was presumably used to help determine where cavitations were. So what did you learn today? Think of about five things you learned from this presentation. Email me if you like. Each module will have different topics. If there's something of particular interest to you, I would love to know about it so that I could throw it up online for everybody else. You can email me at drdawn@drdawn.net. Thanks.